this meeting is to review the notice of intention for the proposed City of Seattle annexation of North Highline area lot.
Hey, could you get closer to the mic, please?
At the conclusion of this evening's session, the Boundary Review Board will determine whether it is necessary to extend the hearing to June 14th, 2016, tomorrow night. And I'll have a roll call.
Evangeline Anderson is excused, and Miguel Beltran is recused. So, Sylvia Bushnell.
Here.
Mary Lynn Evans.
Here.
Claudia Hershey.
Here.
Jay Hamlin.
Here.
Laura Casalias.
Here.
Ronald Little.
Here.
Paul McCready.
Here.
Jim Holhamus.
Here.
And Stephen Choi.
Here. Because the public hearing process is new to most citizens, and in order to ensure an effective public review process, I will begin this evening with a brief description of the general purpose of the Boundary Review Board. The board was established by the state legislature in 1967. Every county in Washington State that plans under the Growth Management Act, that is, every urban county, has a Boundary Review Board, or an equivalent body permitted by RCW 3693. The board is an independent agency. Our purpose is to provide an opportunity for public review of actions, incorporations, mergers, or other boundary changes. Our board has 11 members. 4 members are appointed by the cities of King County. 4 members are appointed by the office of the King County Executive. 3 members come from special purpose districts, such as fire, water, and sewer districts. Members serve 4-year terms. In the matter presently before the board, one member has recused himself, Miguel Beltran, appointed by the cities of King County. In addition, the board is served by 3 staff, Robert Kaufman, Special Attorney General, AHA, Lenora Blum, Executive Secretary, and Angelica Vesquez, Administrative Assistant. Okay, the public hearing will now come to order. The hearing is called to gather facts in the matter of the City of Seattle Notice of Intention for the annexation of North Highline Lot area. A public hearing before this board is a quasi-judicial review. That is, the board functions as a judicial body. A request for review before the board has been filed by a party with standing. The board acts collectively like a judge and is empowered to hear testimony from the applicant, the party seeking review, and members of the public. Following testimony, the board will make a decision on the proposed action. The board's decision will be based on a record consisting of a file of written materials, testimony, and exhibits offered at this hearing. The Boundary Review Board is required to base its decision on several regulations and guidelines. Specifically, the board must consider RCW 3693, sections 170, the factors, and 180, the objectives. This is the state law that creates and guides the board. These factors and objectives are printed on your agenda. The board's decision must also be consistent with the State Growth Management Act, with the King County Comprehensive Plan, and with plans and policies adopted by the applicant, the City of Seattle. Our Executive Secretary will now describe the proposal.
Thank you. I intend to do that. Before I get to that, I'd like to tell you a little bit about the process. The City of Seattle invoked jurisdiction for this file when they submitted the initial notice of intention. They have been working ever since to try to collaborate with the state to make sure that some of the state money, sales tax rebates that had been available for a while would continue to be available to serve this annexation if it were approved. So we've delayed it a bit over time, more than you would normally see an annexation delay. This hearing is very much a public process. You will hear from government agencies. First, the proponent, government agencies, and certainly every member of the public who would like to be heard. It's clear, and was from the beginning, that we won't get to hear from everybody who wants to speak this evening. And that's why we've continued it to tomorrow evening if we need to, and even into Thursday evening if it's necessary. It is a standard fact that when we have one of these public hearings, that there are people who wish we had a broader distribution system for notification. So let me tell you that this hearing was noticed in the Seattle Times, in local newspapers and blogs. The law requires us to put up 10 posters. In fact, we put up 39 or 45 of them, depending upon whether people put up one or two. So, yes, there were people who probably did not hear about this who would have liked to, but it has been our effort to try and include as many people as would be interested. And if you have friends and neighbors who couldn't make it tonight but who would like to be a part of this hearing, please have them join us tomorrow evening. We'll be at exactly the same location. So, with that, in January of 2015, the applicant, the City of Seattle in this case, filed a notice of intention with the Boundary Review Board for the North Highline wide area annexation. You can see maps around the room that clearly depict the boundaries of that. This annexation includes 2,045 acres. The estimated population is about 17,500. The area is located immediately adjacent to the southern boundary of the City of Seattle, and its northernmost boundary is primarily formed by Southwest Roxbury Street. The southern boundary is formed variously by South 107th Street, South 108th Street, South 116th Street, South 112th Street, and goes on in some locations to South 128th Street. And then we've got Seola Beach Drive on the west, and the eastern boundary is generally formed by State Route 99, adjacent to the City of Tukwila. The site includes a wide array of single-family zones, multi-family zones, office, neighborhood commercial, community commercial, regional commercial, and public open spaces, lots of parks in this area. The City of Seattle foresees working with the community to establish specific plans for administration of the North Highline wide area throughout 2016. The actual earliest date for an annexation would be November of 2017, and it might even be extended beyond that. The law does not establish any specific requirements. The City of Seattle has indicated that, they would like to be doing additional work with the community before going to election, and we'll hear more about that from the City of Seattle representatives.
At this time, I will ask board members if there are members who have a conflict of interest, such as a personal interest or professional involvement, which might affect your ability or the perception of your ability to fairly hear this proposal. At this time, would you please so indicate for the record? Mr. Plummings.
Yes, my name is Jim Paul Hamas, and I was at one time the fire chief of King County Fire District number 26. I was also the fire chief of South Kings Fire and Rescue. Both of those departments obtained legal services from Mr. Snur and Mr. Quinn, who I believe will testify tonight. In addition to that, I retired from the fire service in 2006, so it's been 10 years since those professional associations. I'd also, like, addition to that, would say that I've obtained personal legal services from Mr. Smith.
Thank you. Any other? Has any board member had any ex parte communication with any interested party while this matter has been... If any members have had any ex parte communication with any interested party while this matter has been before us, if so, please disclose that information now. If anyone present here tonight has reason to question the ability of any board member to hear and judge fairly under the doctrine of appearance of fairness, please let us know now.
Good evening. My name is Bob Kaufman. I'm the attorney for the board, and we are actually going to start the hearing pretty soon. But before we do that, I'm going to go over some rules that are going to apply during the course of the testimony. If any of you would like to speak this evening, there's a sign-up sheet near the entrance to the room. We ask that you please do so. If any of you have exhibits that you would like the board to consider, please provide copies to Ms. Velasquez, who will be sitting on my far left in that corner. Any exhibits that you give to the Boundary Review Board will be retained by the Boundary Review Board through its decision process, through the appeal process from its decision, which is 30 days after the board makes its decision. So generally speaking, for all intents and purposes, if you do not give the board an original of something that you may not want back, copies are fine for the board. To be most effective in your testimony, we ask that you direct your comments to the factors that the board is intended to consider in making its decision and to the objectives that the board's decisions must advance. And each of those are based on the listed on the agenda that's also at the front of the table. We ask that you please be as brief as possible. It looks like there's going to be a lot of folks here that are going to want to testify tonight, which is great. We want everyone who wants to testify to be heard. However, we do ask that you try not to be overly repetitive. If a witness has already come forward and made a point that you would like to make, it's okay to remind us that a witness has already said something and do you agree with that. However, the 3 minutes that the individuals will be allowed will be yours. In this particular case, the order that we're going to go in, the City of Seattle is the applicant. They're the proponent of this annexation. They will be allowed 20 minutes for their presentation. Following the City of Seattle, King County representatives will have 15 minutes to testify, and thereafter, other governmental units who are interested will each have 10 minutes to testify. Following that testimony from governmental units, the board will take public testimony from community groups and individuals. Each recognized group will have 10 minutes for its presentation. Each individual will have 3 minutes for presentation. We're going to continue this public hearing this evening and tomorrow and possibly the Thursday if necessary, just to make certain that everyone who wants to speak is heard. We do ask that you respect the time limitations that I've just discussed. Ms. Velasquez will be operating a clock. She will be holding up a 1 minute warning just like she is right now. And we ask that you keep an eye out for that. And when your time limit is up, we ask that you please wrap up your comments so others can speak. To ensure that an orderly process, what we're conducting here, folks, is technically considered a quasi-judicial proceeding, which is kind of a 50-cent word, a way of saying that we want to conduct ourselves to the extent possible as if we were in a courtroom. So we want to have the same decorum that we have in a quorum, which basically means if you agree with somebody, something that a witness is saying, please don't cheer, please don't clap. You can do that in a courtroom, so please don't do it here. Similarly, if you disagree with the speaker, the time to express disagreement is when it's your turn at the podium. Please don't do it in the form of any noises from the audience. Only the board members may ask questions of the speakers. If a board member does ask a question of the speaker, the time that the speaker takes to answer the board member's question does not count against the time. I'm the attorney for the Boundary Review Board. If the board has any questions of law, it will refer them to me. Following the testimony by the proponents and other governmental units and groups and individuals, the applicant, the City of Seattle, will get the last word. They will have 10 minutes to do a rebuttal. As the city knows, a rebuttal is not the opportunity for the city to present its case all over again. It's an opportunity for the city to address points that speakers have made in the course of the public hearing. When testimony and exhibits are accepted, the board will close the public hearing and will start its deliberations. I'll just make a comment now. Sometimes, and that's not going to happen this evening, it may not even happen tomorrow evening, we'll see how it goes, but when the board closes the public hearing and starts its public deliberations, it might appear that we're ending the meeting and almost inviting people to leave. That is not the message we want to send. The board's deliberations are part of the public process, and you're welcome and invited to stay during the board's deliberations as well. After the board conducts its deliberations, it will instruct staff to prepare a resolution and hearing decision, which will embody the decision of the board. It's anticipated that the board will take that resolution and hearing up at its September 2016 regular meeting and will act on it then. Everything that's being said this evening is being recorded. Copies of the recordings are available for purchase, and if you're interested, please see Ms. Velasquez about that. Finally, I mentioned earlier that this is a quasi-judicial proceeding. The board members are here to do their job, and they're looking forward to doing their job. They're looking forward to hearing from each and every one of you. But the only place they can hear from you is right here in this room on the record. And what I'm driving at is during a break or after the meeting, as board members may exit the room to go to their cars or wherever, we ask that you please not approach them, because it's entirely inappropriate for board members to discuss any aspect of this proposal outside of a public hearing. And if you were to approach them, you would probably be ignored. It's not because the board member is being rude to you, it's because they're doing their job, which is to base their decision solely on what evidence they have that's submitted in writing. And come before us in the form of testimony. So at this point, I will ask those who will testify to stand if you're able, and to raise your right hand if you're able. Swear or affirm that the testimony you'll give this evening will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. Thank you. Please have a seat.
We'll begin with calling people to testify now. I would like people to know that in the audience we have...
proposal and allow the same to go to a public vote. Tonight, this board has a great opportunity. It is an opportunity to allow the people of North Highline to decide the level of urban services that they wish to receive, and to let them decide whether they will receive those services from the city of Seattle. This is the second phase of Seattle's two-phased approach to annexation of all of the remaining unincorporated territory between Seattle and Burien. The first phase was the Duwamish annexation, which this board approved back in September of 2015 under your file number 2358. You approved that annexation, and that annexation is currently awaiting an election that is scheduled to take place this fall. North Highline, the area that has been variously referred to or previously referred to in board proceedings as Area Y, is the second phase of the city's two-phased approach, and that is the matter before you this evening. Seattle and other jurisdictions in this area have been working for years with the goal of providing a unified government structure for the North Highline area, and the opportunity you have tonight is to allow the people of North Highline to decide whether that unified governance should come from the city of Seattle. As the board knows, and as the executive secretary explained, the North Highline annexation area consists of approximately 2,045 acres of land, the northern boundary of which is coincident with the city of Seattle's current southern boundary, and the southern boundary of which is coincident with the current northern boundary of Burien. And I was struck as I walked in this evening by the aerial photo, which you'll see behind the board to the right, to the board's left, behind you, because you'll see when you look at that aerial photo that this area is intensely urban, and it is an area which, because of its intense urban nature, deserves urban services. Land uses and development on both sides of the current boundaries between Seattle and North Highline are quite similar, with commercial and single-family areas abutting each other. Where the uses across the border are not precisely consistent, there are appropriate transitions between the two, as is the case between the Green Bridge development and single-family areas within Seattle, and as between residential areas in the northeastern areas of North Highline and industrial uses in the city, which are separated by SR 509 and steep slopes. Now, the North Highline annexation area will, in fact, benefit from annexation to the city of Seattle. In the city's brief in support of annexation and in the response we submitted, we have set forth in detail how this annexation meets all of the factors and objectives for the board's review. I'm not going to repeat our brief this evening. I know you've had a chance to read it, and I'm sure we'll appreciate me not repeating it, but I do want to stress several points. First, this annexation makes sense because it unites several neighborhoods that are currently divided from each other by artificial boundaries. The White Center and Delridge neighborhoods will be reunited by this proposal. The Glendale neighborhood will be linked with the South Park area, and neighborhoods that are currently divided by roads, that is, neighborhoods like Roxbury Heights along 30th Avenue Southwest and the South Delridge Triangle, will be reunited by this annexation. Second, as I said a moment ago, this area is intensely urban and it deserves urban services that Seattle is uniquely positioned to provide by virtue of the fact that this annexation is within Seattle's potential annexation area. Seattle's potential annexation is the only potential annexation area that this area is in. And because financially, the city of Seattle is the only city that will have the ability to serve this area. And I'm going to talk about that a little bit more. But the third thing I wanted to say is that this annexation makes sense in that it will ensure that high levels of urban municipal services are provided to the residents and businesses, and that service levels will, in fact, improve. As the declaration of Chief Wilski from the Seattle Police Department, which is in the record, indicates, The Seattle Police Department's law enforcement services will be extended into this area with staffing levels that greatly exceed those that are currently provided by the County Sheriff's Department. In addition to the SPD patrols, which will have a minimum of 12 officers and 2 sergeants on duty at any time, the residents and businesses of North Highline will have access to community police team officers, anti-crime team officers, detective services, SWAT, the bomb and arson SWAT, and the gang unit. Now, in addition to police services, there will be additional social and community services that will be improved in this area. Seattle will offer, through its Department of Neighborhoods, neighborhood matching grants, P-Patch community gardens, public outreach and engagement liaisons, and find it fixing community blocks. It will offer planning services through the Seattle Office of Planning and Community Development. It will offer home visiting programs, preschool programs, at-risk youth grants, student health services, and summer learning programs through the Seattle Department of Early Learning. It will offer no-cost business consulting, business loan programs, one-stop problem-solving, action plan, and other business-related services to the businesses within the White Center area and throughout North Highline through the City of Seattle's Office of Economic Development. And library services will be offered through Seattle Public Libraries, which includes continued access to the King County Library System. I submitted for the record tonight an exhibit. It is marked as Exhibit A. It is the reciprocal agreement that Seattle Public Libraries has with King County Library Systems, and it shows that individuals, patrons of the library system within both jurisdictions are allowed to check out books and return books from the other library system. So we do have a reciprocal agreement in place. Utility services will remain the same. I want to stress this point because there were some letters that were submitted to the board from utility service districts. This action, as the board knows, is to annex the North Highline area. Assumption of the utility districts is not an issue that is before you this evening, and assumption is a separate process that requires separate review by this board and potentially a separate vote by the people within those districts. And I would say that not only is assumption not proposed this evening, but as we pointed out in our brief, assumption, at least of the sewer districts, is highly unlikely in the next 6 years because the tax incentive that the city is relying on to be able to close the financial gap between the revenues necessary to serve this area and the urban services that it requires provides that it just cannot be used if the city provides sewer service. So if the city were to provide sewer service in the North Highline annexation area, the city would forfeit approximately $7.75 million per year of revenue over the next 6 years, which would be very difficult for the city to do and still annex this area. So that is simply not on the table, and those utilities will continue to provide services just as they have been doing. Fire service will be the same or will be improved. The city will continue to operate the North Highline Fire District's headquarters station, Station 18. By virtue of the law relating to annexation, as the city annexes into this area, it acquires the assets of the fire district, and if it annexes into North Highline, it would acquire the headquarters station 18. The station will be staffed 24/7 with an engine company consisting of 4 fire professionals, 1 more than the district currently staffs the engine company with. Response times for Engine 18 will be the same as they are currently from Station 18, but there will be more personnel. The city also has 3 fire stations in reasonable proximity to the North Highline annexation area that are available to provide service in the event of a major incident. And if you look at the board, which is up, it's a second from the left as I'm facing the board, so it'll be on the board's right. There is a map showing these fire stations. You'll see that Station 18 is located approximately center left in the annexation area, just to the bottom of the annexation area. And you will see Seattle's fire stations, the three fire stations, 37, 11, and 26, that are available to provide service in the North Highline area should that be needed. As our materials indicate, the response times from those fire stations are approximately a minute to a minute and a half longer than they are from Station 15. Seattle will also provide specialty fire services to the North Highline area that others cannot provide, including hazardous materials response team, a technical rescue response team, and a dive rescue response team that will all be available to provide service in this area. Now, we know that both Fire District 11 and Fire District 2 have submitted statements in opposition to the annexation, and I want to address those objections just briefly. I will address them again in rebuttal after I hear, after we hear what the districts do have to say. But first, I want to say that the City of Seattle recognizes that there is a response issue with respect to ALS services. As we pointed out in our response brief, if we were to provide ALS services from the current Fire Station 32, which is located at Southwest Alaska Street in West Seattle, the response time would be 14 minutes. And as everybody knows, that is unacceptable. It's unacceptable to the City of Seattle, and it's something which the City of Seattle will need to work on. There are a number of possible solutions to that. There are things that Seattle has looked at before, such as moving the medic unit from Station 32 further south towards the annexation. That's one possibility. There's the possibility of making the engine company a paramedic engine company, which Seattle has done at times in the past, the station paramedic on the engine. There's also the opportunity to look at mutual aid agreements or an agreement with South King County Medic Corps to allow them to respond automatically into the area. I can tell you that the Seattle Fire Department can and will solve this issue, so that residents and businesses of North Highline will receive ALS services in a timely manner, commensurate what Seattle's current residents and businesses receive. I'm sure the board can appreciate that Seattle is not going to annex an area and provide services to it, which are very, very much less than what is provided in other areas of the City of Seattle. It can be done. But I do want to say that this is an operational issue for the fire department. It is an operational issue that the Seattle Fire Department can and will resolve. And it should not be grounds for denying this annexation. The Seattle Fire Department is very much a professional fire organization, as I think everyone would appreciate. And the Seattle Fire Department will, in fact, find a way to provide services to the community in the most efficient way possible. With respect to automatic aid, Seattle does believe that automatic aid is beneficial. Seattle is currently involved in discussions with federal agencies to formalize automatic aid agreements. There are a number of logistics to work out, as you would expect, in something as large as that. And for those that may not know about automatic aid is a situation in which the closest fire unit responds to a fire call regardless of political boundaries. So if a call comes in, the closest unit goes without the need for anything to be called out from another jurisdiction. In contrast to that is mutual aid, where a jurisdiction has to actually request service from another agency to come in and help. But Seattle is looking at automatic aid agreements, but again, we believe that is an operational issue that, and not one that should be used to deny this annexation. As you can see, Seattle has not needed automatic aid in the past because it has fire stations which are close enough to provide service throughout the Seattle boundaries, and these three fire stations that the city has, 11, 37, and 26, when you couple that with North Highline Station 18, will be adequate to serve. Fire District 11 has also raised the issue of the timing of this annexation versus the timing of the Duwamish annexation. And as we pointed out in our response, Seattle's agreement with Fire District 11 will cover some of those possibilities, but the state RCW, RCW 35.02.190, ensures that all areas will get served regardless of the sequence in which annexations occur. Finally, Fire District 2 has raised concerns about their ability to serve North Huron after the annexation, and as we pointed out in our response, the agreement under which Fire District 2 claims that King County and Seattle are obligated to provide it with land expired in 2012. And I think Ms. Freeman from the county is going to address that in her presentation. But Seattle does not have a responsibility to provide Fire District 2 with land. Seattle is willing to sit down with Fire District 2 to discuss how North Burien could be served after annexation. And there is currently a meeting scheduled for June the 29th, between which my understanding is that's the earliest the district had available to meet with the city to discuss those options and so intends to do that. Seattle is the only city that can bring unified governance and an urban level of service to the North Highline annexation area. As we mentioned in our opening brief in this matter and also in our response, other cities are not able to provide service to this area. If North Highline is going to receive urban services, if it is going to be served by a city and be within the city's boundaries, Seattle is where it will have to go, since Seattle is the only one who has North Highline in its potential annexation area at present time. Burien can't do it. Burien came to you and asked for the ability to vote in the voters to annex North Highline. Burien was given that opportunity. Voters overwhelmingly rejected that annexation, and Burien has now taken this area out of its potential annexation area. But not only is Seattle the only one with this area in its potential annexation area, but Seattle is the only city that has the financial opportunity to provide the services to North Highline. North Highline needs urban services. To get those services, it has to be in the city. County is simply not equipped to provide those services because it is a regional entity that is equipped to provide regional services. And the reason why Seattle is the only city that can financially do this is because the tax legislation, which the legislature passed in 2016, basically limits the tax incentive to this annexation. In order to qualify, the annexation had to be filed by January 1, 2015, in order to qualify, that had to occur. Seattle is the only one with an annexation pending, and if this annexation does not go through, that tax incentive is gone, and there will be nothing. No revenue to provide services. In closing, I would just say that tonight the request of you is to allow people to vote. We're not asking you to decide that the North Highline area come into the city of Seattle. The people get a chance to do that, and what we're asking you to do is to give them that opportunity. Thank you, and we're available to answer your questions.
Do any members have questions for Ms. Hayes?
Good evening. I have two questions with regard to the fire service and the ALS. We discussed options. Does City of Seattle, for the city itself, have policy or guidelines on minimum thresholds for response time for ALS or policy on equity and how it's served around the city?
I'm looking for Chief Hagan to see if he's around to answer that question.
evening, members of the board. My name is Chief Jay Hagan. On behalf of Seattle's Fire Chief Harold Scoggins, thank you for the opportunity to address you this evening. I do have just a few comments that I think will address your question. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. So in 2015, the total number of advanced life support incidents that Seattle Fire responded to was 19,897, so just under 20,000. And of those advanced life support alarms, we transported 2,247 times. So about 11.3% of the time, Seattle Fire Department medic unit, of which there are seven, would transport a patient to the hospital. Regarding response times for the calendar year 2015, the average response time from time assigned to arriving at the scene was 6 minutes, 8 seconds. That includes call processing. So from en route to on scene, so that's from when they're in the unit, they turn the key, turn the motor on in the unit, that was just under 5 minutes, at 4 minutes, 58 seconds, average response time. It's probably important to note that the secret recipe for success of the Medic One system is the layered nature of the response. So having the North Highline Engine 18, or if it was a Seattle engine, having the EMTs arrive first, perform an initial assessment, and prepare the way for the advanced life support unit, that's the recipe for success. It's also important to note that I think one of the reasons that the Seattle Fire Department medic units are so special is that our slowest medic unit is busier than the busiest King County medic unit. So we're able to, through repetition, saturate the skills. Some of the skills are very intricate and delicate and take a lot of practice. And so that's one of the things we're very proud of, is that the paramedics in the Seattle Fire Department have high repetition and low skill degradation. Does that address your question?
Yes, more or less. So then what occurs after annexations, should this area be annexed by Seattle, is the way you govern and distribute your services would remain equitable throughout Seattle.
As Jim mentioned, that's an operational concern. It's completely solvable, and we're looking at options right now on how best to tackle that problem should this area become part of Seattle.
Thank you. And then, Jim, I have one more question for you. In order to come up with these options and solve this problem, what would be the timeline? I guess what I'm asking is, from now until the vote and then the Seattle budget resolution, and you have an official date for when now Seattle has to start providing service, what kind of time frame is there to solve these problems?
Well, I don't know that there's any specific time frame. Obviously, in this particular annexation, we're not looking for going to vote this fall and annex and have the annexation occur at the end of this year. We're looking at, I believe the timeline is more 2019, is that correct, Ken? So we've got some time to solve the issue and to look at it. One of the things that Seattle Fire Department needs to do is to look at the revenues from this area and to look at all of its obligations and make some strategic decisions as to how we can move things around. But I think, as Chief Hagan said, Seattle is committed to doing that and making this work, and Seattle does not allow some areas of the city to receive great service and other areas of the city not to. All of the areas of the city will receive good service.
Thank you.
Ms. Evans?
Mr. Haney, I want to make sure that I understood what you said. Earlier you said that Assumption is not before us as part of this annexation. I understand that Assumption is a separate process. Well, would you not agree that we have the obligation to look at fire service levels and response levels under our factors and criteria?
Yes, I believe that you do have the obligation to look at fire service and at whether or not a jurisdiction can provide adequate fire service. We believe you can provide that, and we believe you've shown you can provide that. What I'm saying is that there are certain operational issues about how you do that that I'm not sure need to be solved at the moment. The city of Seattle can tell you, as you look at the way in which the city provides fire services currently, we can tell you what the city's standards are. The city's standards with respect to response times for an engine company are NFPA standards. Those are nationwide standards, and the city is providing response times in the area of between 4 and 4.5 minutes. Chief Hagan just told you that the city's standard or average response time currently for medic services is about 6 minutes. And so those are the standards that we'll be working towards. How we exactly solve those, I'm not sure we need to do at this point. But you need to have, I agree, you need to have assurances that the city can indeed provide those, and it provides that throughout the city.
Would it be possible for you, either tonight or tomorrow in the rebuttal, to tell us some ways you might possibly solve them, i.e., would you be looking to locate another station? Would you be doing mutual aid agreements? Do you traditionally do mutual aid agreements?
I can certainly address those. I can tell you now that the city of Seattle, as I said, with respect to ALS services, with respect to the basic life support services, we're going to provide those through Station 18, because we will take over Station 18 as part of the annexation. So basic life support will be 4 to 4.5 minutes. It will meet the city's standards. Advanced life support, as I told you, there are a number of options on the table. There are options like moving the medic service unit from its current location at Station 32 slightly south, but you need to obviously balance that with what it provides the areas it's serving in the northern part of West Seattle. There are options of contracting with South County Medic Unit to allow to have them respond, and we would be able to work a mutual agreement on that. The city has, as I said in the past, had the idea of a paramedic, deployed the idea of a paramedic fire engine, where one of the three firefighters on the engine is actually a paramedic and has the ability to provide those ALS services immediately. So those are all options that are being considered. But at this point, no particular option has been decided upon. But the city is very confident that from those options, the city will be able to provide the service at the levels that Seattle is currently providing.
Thank you.
Mr. McCready?
Questions as well. Sticking with the fire, I have a question about the automatic aid.
Yes.
Excuse me. You had stated that. Take a drink of water here. You had stated that in negotiating with other districts to provide automatic aid. There's other districts, other jurisdictions besides the city, or I guess it's the Fire District 2, other districts besides Fire District 2 that you're negotiating. First of all, and the second part of that question is this a change of policy for the city?
Let me call Chief Hagan up if I could, have him do that, since he's been the one who was involved in those discussions, and he can tell you what is currently happening.
Thank you. In King County, all the fire departments in King County are divided into three zones. Zone 1 is the east and north suburbs. Zone 3 is the south and southwest suburbs. And then the city of Seattle is the geographic Zone 5. Currently in Zone 3, there are automatic aid arrangements happening right now today. They have formed a training consortium where they share training expenses and opportunities, and actually had quite a bit of success with that. And they also respond in an automatic aid basis, which, as we said earlier, is closest unit goes, regardless of political boundary. So that's actually happening, I think, pretty well in Zone 3. In Zone 1, it's happening a little bit, and in Seattle, we're not quite there yet. We do have mutual aid agreements. For example, we routinely send a Seattle medic unit north into Shoreline to cover their need, and they do the same for us. We also send one of our ladder trucks from Northgate up to Shoreline. But that the mutual aid
that Seattle will be providing the area, and particularly the social services. And actually, this may be a question for King County, not you, but I just wanted to know, do you know what services that the city will be providing that are not offered by King County?
Well, I'll let this room talk about that, but I can tell you right now that my understanding is that King County has very little in the way of human services that it provides in this particular area, and that the city of Seattle's, particularly the business services that Seattle will provide, the early education services that Seattle will provide, those are services that King County is simply not set up to provide at this point.
Which ones are not provided today?
Back to the here. Who currently provides ALS services to the annexation area?
I believe that's South County Medic Corps.
And do you know what that current response time is to the annexation area?
I do not know, although I do know that the medic unit very recently moved to downtown Burien. So it is located in downtown Burien.
Would it be possible, perhaps for rebuttal, to get that current response time of the annexation area, if that's a statistic that's actually available?
If it's available, we'll definitely get that for you.
Thank you.
I have a question on police response times. So the station for Southwest Precinct at 23 and Southwest Webster is the location that dispatching will occur. With annexation of North Highline and the precinct and sector beat map, once that's revised, do you have any indication of what the effect on response times will be? They will be within, according to the NOI, the established standards for priority 1, 2, 3, and 4 calls, but just wondering what the difference is between current dispatch time and...
I do not have that, but we'll make sure that we get that for you. What I can tell you is that my understanding is that there are currently 2 King County Sheriff's deputies on duty to patrol this area. We are proposing to have a squad of 6 at a minimum, with a 6-member backup and 2 sergeants on duty. That's the minimum shift in the first watch. And that rises to 8 officers, an 8-member squad, and an 8-member backup surge squad, I guess they call it, with 2 sergeants during the second shift or second watch. So there's going to be a lot more police officers out there, and they will be patrolling. Plus, you have the community police officer who is out there going around all the time, checking on things, checking troubled areas and so forth. And you have the anti-crime team officer who is also in the area. So we're planning on putting a lot more police on the streets to serve this area than are currently out there now. And I take that back. To actually King County, I believe, has 2 officers, 2 sheriff's deputies out there now, and maybe there's also an officer at the storefront, which is, there is a storefront where the King County Sheriff's Department maintains a storefront in White Center. And so we'll have a lot more officers than that on duty and on active patrol.
Any more questions from the board?
Chair, will we have a chance to talk about fees with water and sewer districts at some point, or should we ask our questions now?
Water and sewer districts.
I could wait to the water and sewer districts.
I'm happy to answer a question if you want about it relates to the city of Seattle.
I think there was information that the sewer and water fees would go up exponentially under the assumption by the city of Seattle. And I believe I read somewhere, and maybe one of the other board members can help me find this, where it might be 2 to 3 times what it is now. And I was wondering if there was some explanation for that. Let me see if I can find it while you're answering.
Well, I think where you saw it was in the water, I believe, in the water and sewer district letters, there was some indication of that. But again, assumption is not proposed at the present time, so we haven't addressed rates. I can tell you that with respect to the utility rates in the area, the water and sewer districts will continue to serve their customers in the area. We are not proposing assumption at this point. The rate should stay the same, with one small exception, and that is that the City of Seattle, to all utilities that operate within the city's limits, the city does charge a franchise fee for those utilities, but that franchise fee only recoups the city's costs of actually administering the franchise system. And so it is, you know, pennies on the dollar. It's very little. It's a very small amount. So you will not see the types of utility fee growth that the water and sewer districts say, because we're not proposing assumption. And again, the sewer, it would be suicidal for the City of Seattle to assume the sewer because of the tax issue.
And that's with the caveat of a 6-year time frame. Beyond that, other things, assumption may happen.
Yes, and if it is proposed at that time, of course it has to come back to this board,
right,
and all of those questions about rates and costs and all that stuff are absolutely fair game. And that's not being proposed now.
And how about utilities like Comcast and CenturyLink? Does the city have a surcharge on those that is different than what the county has?
I do not know off the top of my head. What I can tell you is that the city is not in the business of providing those services, so the city is not going to be providing those services. There would, in the same instance, be a franchise fee. I can tell you that with respect to cable television, that the federal act which governs cable television limits the amount of the fee that you can charge. It is 5% of the gross revenues. Virtually everybody who has cable television within their jurisdictions charges that same fee, but that's a matter of federal law. It is cut off at that amount.
And it's true for cities and counties.
That is correct. Mm-hmm. And I can tell you as well that at least for cities, there is a limit on the amount of utility tax that you may impose on telephone and providers as well.
And then one last question. On all these utility fees, sewer, water, franchises, all of them, are those fees earmarked to go back to the use of the utility or the franchise, or can they be turned over to other parts of the general, call it the general fund?
Okay. Utility fees that are charged by utilities go directly to the utility. If you think about utilities, they're actually treated as separate entities under state law from the city, in a sense. They're a separate enterprise fund is what it's called in state law.
That's the word I want.
Yes, it's a separate enterprise fund is what it's called in the state law. And a utility that charges its utility fees, those fees go back directly to the utility, and the utility uses those to provide utility service. Now, a city that charges a franchise fee to a utility is essentially charging the utility for the privilege of operating a money-making utility business within the city limits. Those franchise fees that jurisdictions charge go into the general fund. They are not limited to the utility, because the management of the franchise comes out of the general fund.
Thank you, Bruno.
Mr. Little?
Yes, I just wanted to clarify a little bit. From notice of intention, it was pretty clear to me that it was the intent of Seattle to annex the water and sewer districts. I understand the legislation about the sewer districts postponed it, but is it the policy of the city council to serve water and sewer within the city limits or something like that?
Well, Well, ultimately, yes, that is the city's policy. The city does provide water and sewer service throughout its city limits. But, again, assumption is a separate process, and it's not part of the process.
Well, I understand that, but also, you can't assume it if you don't annex it first.
Yes.
So you're correct. It's a two-step process. If you don't annex the area, then you wouldn't be able to annex take on water and sewer districts.
Yes, there are some circumstances in which a city can, if part of the water district or sewer district is located inside the city,
right,
assume the entire district. But you're basically correct.
I've been out of business for about 5 years now, so I'm not really up to date with the current. But I think it was Water District 20's statements here kind of describe, there's a new process in 3513A, I think, right?
That's correct.
And so how would that impact the city if the annexation did succeed, but in 5 or 6 years when they decide to do something, how would the current statutes apply if the city decided to assume one of the water districts?
Well, if the city decided to assume, of course, the statutes that were in effect at that time would apply. But the way that the current statute is worded and the major change that occurred is that the statute now says that upon assumption of a water and sewer district, first of all, the city would have to pass an ordinance to assume. It would have to file a notice of intent with this board. This board would have to approve the assumption. The city would then pass the assumption, and then there would be a referendum process which is available to voters within the water or sewer district that is being assumed, whereby they could ask for a public vote on the assumption, and if they voted against assumption, the assumption would not occur. So that is what is new in the
And so is that of the entire water district, or is that just the portion of the water district that's within the city limits?
I believe that is, if you're assuming the entire water district, it would be the entire water district.
Right.
If you're assuming only a portion, I believe that only that portion
we'll be able to ask water districts.
Yes, and I can certainly look at that as well and provide additional information.
Any questions? Okay, thank you, Mr. Henry.
Thank you very much for your attention, and thanks to all of the people here for being here. I know it's those of us who get paid to be here to stand before you. I know we appreciate all the people who aren't getting paid, and we have the opportunity to come out and talk. And Seattle is very willing to listen to all of the folks here. We appreciate your attention.
King County, Karen Freeman.
My name is Karen Freeman, and I'm here on behalf of King County. I'm a senior policy analyst and project manager in the regional planning and government relations sections of the executive office. King County appreciates the city of Seattle moving forward with a notice of intent to annex North Highline Area Y, and we appreciate the board's consideration this evening. The King County region has been advancing smart growth since the Growth Management Act was passed, and King County government has developed and implemented land use policies that support resilient, healthy, diverse, and sustainable communities. This policy development has included an ongoing conversation with our city partners that has taken place over the last decade as cities claim the unincorporated parts of the county that have become urban and therefore need to move into neighboring cities as envisioned by GMA so they can receive the urban level services they need. This is because counties were designed to provide regional and rural services, and cities were designed to provide local services to dense urban populations. That's the key issue here for King County. Carefully transitioning our last remaining urban islands into the cities that have claimed these areas so that the citizens in these areas get the urban level services that they desperately need. This entire project was envisioned to close in 2012, and we are way beyond that date, and I think everyone in the room probably feels the pain of that. I I've been working on the North Highline annexation since 2007, though many of you and others in the room have been working on this issue much longer. Folks will recall that North Highline is the only urban island in King County that was claimed by more than one city as a potential annexation area. The cities of Burien, SeaTac, Seattle, and Tukwila all claim parts of North Highline as their PAA, thus creating overlapping designations. This has never happened before, nor since, and in fact cannot happen again because the countywide planning policies, which were created in partnership with the cities in King County, now prohibit overlapping designations. A quick history. In 2008, the city of SeaTac removed North Highline from their comp plan. Then, through mediated discussions that began in 2008, the remaining cities developed a governance transition framework around the realization that North Highline was too big an urban island for any one city to annex. So the agreement created a path forward with annexation attempts by cities in a coordinated way. Burien annexed the southern portion of North Highline, known as Area X, in April of 2010, moving over 14,000 people into their city. They then attempted to annex the northern portion of North Highline, but nearly 65% of the votes the folks that voted on that proposal voted no. The city of Burien then chose to remove the Area Y PAA from their comp plan, and as a result, are no longer eligible to annex Area Y. In 2012 and 2013, Tukwila worked on an attempt to annex Area Q, also known as the Triangle, and that proposal was not approved by the BRB. Next, the city of Seattle received approval from the BRB in 2015 to move forward with an annexation attempt of the Duwamish annexation, which consists of the Triangle, also known as Area Q, and the Sliver. And the county and the city are working on an interlocal agreement to facilitate that governance transfer. The city's hoping for a November 2016 ballot measure. Now Seattle is here before the board with a notice of intent to annex Area Y. Something very important to highlight is that the status quo
current level of service... Can I ask you to slow down a little bit, please?
Yes, sorry.
That's okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Sorry about that. The status quo current levels of service provided by the county are not adequate and not sustainable. This is a key issue. Cities and counties have very different taxing authorities that are, in general, appropriate for the level of service they provide. The mix of county funding sources are limited. As a result, county funding is not enough to support urban level areas like North Highline. We don't generate enough revenue to support urban level services that communities like North Highline desperately need. Cities do have the right mix of funding sources, and they do generate enough revenue to support urban level services, like the services that North Highline needs. In addition, Seattle will receive revenues from the state sales tax credit to incentivize the annexation tool, and it's important, and those services, that money will flow to services only in the annexation area. It's important to note these funds have now sunset, are no longer available to any other city in the future, making Seattle's proposal very time sensitive. A current look at county service levels in contrast to Seattle's proposed service levels highlights the difference between what a county can provide and what a city can provide. And this goes to the question that you asked, Mr. McCready. If, just to consider a couple of these kinds of services, consider our roads department, which exists, which we actually require about $350 million in annual funding in order to maintain our road service, but we only have access to $100 million annually. So this limits our work to immediate safety issues, clean water requirements required by law, and a very modest amount of maintenance and preservation. At this level of funding, infrastructure continues to deteriorate. We've reduced our staff by 45% and are only able to plow 15% of the roads during snow events. We're struggling. We don't have the funding necessary to keep up with urban level service needs. Seattle, by contrast, has a healthy transportation budget funded by a $930 million levy. Consider police services. The King County Sheriff's Office currently staffs North Highline with two deputies on the street and a storefront deputy. The city of Seattle is proposing three shifts with a minimum of six officers and two sergeants. Some of those shifts will have as many as two officers, as well as a community police team officer and an anti-crime team officer, all dedicated to North Highline. For human services, King County spends $20,000 annually on local human services in North Highline to help fund the local food bank. That is it. The City of Seattle Human Services Department provides $89 million in annual funding through 450 contracts to nearly 200 agencies that support Seattle's most vulnerable residents each year in a city of 600,000 residents. King County does provide some regional human services, and I provided an exhibit to Angelica to distribute, and those are here. We provide these services through a regional levy to King County's 2 million residents.
Excuse me, Karen, that's exhibit B on your table.
Thank you. Mr. Haney mentioned economic development. They have an entire department and team that do that. We have one FTE that works on regional economic development, and that's mostly focused on large sector services. For community planning, again, the City of Seattle has an entire department that does this. We have one FTE that works on community planning for all of King County. As you can see, the levels of service provided by the City of Seattle are far superior to what the county provides currently or could ever provide, because we were never designed to provide urban rural services. That's a city's job. And the City of Seattle is uniquely qualified to provide urban level services to North Highline due to the size of the city and the application of a sales tax credit to fund services in the annexation area, which they grandfathered themselves into. I just wanted to mention briefly the MOU transition framework that, to clarify a couple points that Fire District 2 made in their memo to the board. The district stated that the transition framework document was a standalone document with no sunset date, and with all due respect to the district, that's not the case. I staffed these documents for the executive when they were created in 2008. They were part of a package. The transition framework was an attachment to the memorandum of understanding document. Both documents have the same date noted on them at the bottom. And in fact, item 5, page 1 of the MOU states that the transition framework is an attachment. The package of documents, which included the MOU and the transition framework, were effective until January 1st of 2012, and the MOU stated that in its final item, number 10, page 2. In the 4 years since the package of documents expired, no one from any jurisdiction has brought this issue up to me or to any of my other colleagues at the county. The county has repeatedly encouraged all service jurisdictions to plan for their eventual future state of annexation into a city or cities, and to plan for all various potential outcomes, of which there were many because of the overlapping designations. In addition, North Highline annexations of various forms have been before the board on 3 separate occasions over the last 6 years, and we've all been here with the board talking about what's coming next on those 3 occasions. In addition, we've sat in a room together through many mediated discussions that have taken place. The county is facing a projected $50 million budget shortfall in our 2016-2017 budget, and so we regrettably do not have land or dollars to offer. But we do stand ready to participate in conversations to find creative solutions to all the issues that arise from the North Highline annexation. In closing, the county fully supports realizing the vision of GMA in which residents in urban areas receive the urban level services they need. Seattle's proposal realizes that important vision for North Highline, and King County is fully supportive of placing this issue before the voters for their consideration. We thank the board for your consideration of this proposal and can entertain any questions.
Any questions from board members?
Going back to the services that the county can't provide, is it possible for you to get a list of those? Just to the list you claim that they're not going to be able to provide them. So I'd just like to have a list of what services you can't provide and the city will.
Yeah, I can do that for you.
Just out of curiosity, there's some wonderful King County housing projects in this area.
Yeah.
What will happen to those after the next session?
So the King County Housing Authority is a separate governmental entity that's not related to King County government. We do have our own small housing division within our community and human services department, but most of that work is federal pass-through dollars to projects in King County. So King County Housing Authority operates separately, and those their projects will continue to move forward.
On the transition framework, can you give some background on the thinking regarding the land for an fire station in North Greering? What was the, because I realized the expiration in 2012 was an assessment, but what was the thinking in 2008 regarding that?
So I think that, we were highlighting issues that were presenting themselves that were challenges that we needed to work together to solve. My chief of staff at the time said, hey, by 2012, the King County-wide planning policies envisioned that all of these annexations would be completed by 2012. At the time, we had 12 large urban islands. We've worked with the board. We now have 5 urban islands, so we're more than halfway there, but we did not complete that exercise. And his thought at the time was, in 2012, I'll be done with this. These areas that draw more revenue than they're able to generate, that would give me a little bit of leverage in my budget, and I might be able to do something to help move this annexation forward to meet that 2012 deadline. But we did not complete all of our annexations, and in fact, the agreement expired, and here we are.
Just to make sure I'm clear, from the perspective of 2008, I'm interested, there will be funding from completion of annexations to allow for the purchase of the land.
At the time, he was thinking, "Oh, I'll be done with all my annexations. So these large urban islands that are drawing more revenues than they generate, I might have a little flexibility with my budget to help the fire district purchase a piece of land, if that will help move the issue forward in a timely way." That was the key, and it did not move forward in a timely way.
Any questions from the board? Any further questions? Thank you, Ms. Green. The board is going to have a 5-minute break.